70 years ago, just as we do today, Britons sorted their waste on the doorstep.
Here, the professor wants to talk to you.
Thanks, but I've left school and I'm going out to play.
Here, don't you know there's a war on?
In the Second World War, the British government mobilised everything for its war industries, including the household bin. The infrastructure for recycling, or salvage as it was then called, was provided by the waste management industry. But putting the right rubbish in the right bin was a citizen's job.
How do you do? Ah, bones. What is the use of old bones?
Every scrap of bone is useful. Glycerine is also got from the bones and is used for making high explosives.
During the war, 9 million tons of household rubbish was salvaged, equivalent to the weight of 200 battleships.
Here we go, boys! Yippee!
But by 1945, Britain was running out of vital necessities. Fuel, food and clothes were rationed, as they had been throughout the conflict. People simply couldn't afford to throw things away. British cooks of the 1940s left nothing to waste.
An appetizing mixture of soft roes and baked spuds in their jackets.
The few leftovers that cooks could find no use for were fed to farm animals. On street corners, there were pig bins to collect kitchen scraps.
Yes, that's how you'll all save your bacon.
It was a wartime propaganda campaign that had first taught people to produce less rubbish and instead make do and mend.
We'll join forces and make John a new sweater.
Yo, swish.
Well, why not get together with your friends and form a make, do and mend group?
By the late 40s, war and austerity had moulded the way Britons thought about rubbish. All that went in the bin was what householders could find no use for.
Would rest on the belt. It's getting the knack. Altogether, you're lifting up over half a hundredweight, perhaps going up.
The bins weighed so much because half of British household rubbish was ash that had been raked out of the fire grate. This was where the term dustbin came from.
It was strenuous, but after a...
Coal ash had been the main constituent of household rubbish for over a century, since the coal-fired hearth became the centre of British family life. But in the mid-50s, the waste management industry was caught unawares by a sudden change in British rubbish. It was a side effect of a government anti-pollution law called the Clean Air Act. The smoke produced by Britain's millions of coal fires had been contributing to a national nuisance.
Smog is simply natural fog which is polluted by the discharges from burning fuel.
4,000 people died in the Great Smog of 1952. So the Clean Air Act created smokeless zones in which open fires were restricted. The impact on air pollution was an immediate improvement. The refuse collectors' lives got easier too. It was an early sign that the coal-fired era, which dated back to the 19th century's Industrial Revolution, was at last passing into history.
Thank you.
The composition of the household bin changed rapidly in the post-war period. Within a decade of the Clean Air Act, the share of British household rubbish that was coal ash halved. But the share of paper, cardboard and glass doubled. So though the rubbish was getting lighter, the volume of it was rising.
Refuse, rubbish, garbage, gash, trash, waste. Each person throws away 400 or 500 weight of it a year.
The bulky trash was the result of a new kind of shopping habit that was sweeping through Britain in the 1950s. Rationing ended in 1954, and austerity was at last giving way to affluence.
The transatlantic phenomenon has at last made its mark in British shops, the self-service store.
Now, British shoppers were enjoying an innovation that had recently appeared on the high street, the self-service shop. It had been pioneered in 30s America, but was a novelty in post-war Britain. Self-service shops encouraged shoppers to be curious, not just to look, but to touch as well. So to protect the produce from those feeling fingers, everything had to be packaged.
Packages basically make possible the kind of display that you're going to get in the post-war supermarkets.
Of course, once what has been bought is consumed, its wrapping becomes rubbish.
So let's talk rubbish. 370,000 tons of it.
There was no national strategy for dealing with the changes in the rubbish brought about by the Clean Air Act and self-service shops. Once the war was won, responsibility for waste management was in the hands of the country's local authorities. In London, this meant a patchwork of boroughs. But in Birmingham, one authority collected the rubbish for the entire city of over 1 million people. This was the largest such operation in Britain.
And that's not talking rubbish.
Languishing in the stores of the city's Technology Museum is the forgotten workhorse of Birmingham's post-war refuse collection system. These post-war dust carts had been designed in the 1930s.
That's how you turned, and you couldn't reverse.
The reason for the sluggish pace and the lack of manoeuvrability was that these dust carts were electric-powered. They were more like milk floats than heavy-duty trucks. In the late 1950s, the volume of rubbish in Birmingham rose so fast, the dust carts were running out of juice. Birmingham City Council persevered with electric dust carts because what was at stake was more than a technology. It was the City Council's entire philosophy of waste management. The department of Birmingham City Council that oversaw refuse collection was called the Salvage Department.
The whole culture of Birmingham was always a culture of trying to use waste in whatever way they can.
Bob Evans was a manager in Birmingham's Salvage Department.
The waste from the jewellery quarter, the gold and the platinum, and they reused that and sold it back to them and used it again. The whole emphasis was on conservation of materials and reuse of materials, even from that period of time, yes, it was.
So Birmingham dustmen didn't just collect rubbish. They often earned overtime hand-sorting it for recyclables.
I used to sit on the belt picking bits of rag off or picking tins up or whatever it went through.
Paper, cloth, metal, glass was picked off the conveyor belt of rubbish. The city council sold these materials to Britain's recycling sector. In the early post-war period, there was money in muck. For instance, in 1959, a quarter of all Britain's paper was made from recycled sources.
You've got to have a good stomach to stomach these, to stomach that job, haven't you?
Well into the 50s, Birmingham's salvage department seemed to show that recycling, which had helped win the war, could also flourish in modern Britain. But at the heart of Birmingham's waste management operation was a technology from the previous century. What couldn't be salvaged was incinerated in huge furnaces called destructors. These were a Victorian invention. But in 1950, Birmingham was one of many British cities still using them.
They'd have to do quite a lot of lifting and shifting. Shift this across, and then what you'd have here, you'd have a big, huge amount of heat coming out of here because this would be feeding direct into the grate. It would be a steaming, hissing, dusty, dirty place.
Destructors reduced rubbish to a sterile ash. It was often used as a building material in Britain's post-war redevelopment. Even the heat produced from burning rubbish was exploited. It generated electricity. In Birmingham, it was used to charge the batteries on the dust carts. It was an ingenious system with almost zero waste. Today, this would be considered a model of environmental awareness. But during the late 50s, the mood in Britain was becoming less thrifty. In 1957, Prime Minister Harold Macmillan declared Britain had never had it so good. There was consistent full employment and wages were rising fast.
Record shops, fashion shops, every little town gets a boutique or even two boutiques.
As well as the new shops, there was a rapidly growing advertising industry. Packages became hoardings. Television began carrying commercials in 1955.
Mother's pride, baked according to my own original recipe.
Adverts encouraged people to shop for new things. One way this was done was to convince shoppers that what was left over from before the war was now past it. Battered pans, toys, damaged bikes, tired clothes. If it was pre-war in late 1950s Britain, it was rubbish.
Take a look at this.
In 1960, the reporter John Morgan made a documentary claiming there was a crisis in British waste management.
The refuse of a couple of days from one home. As a nation, we create 12 million tons of refuse every year, which means that you personally create 500 wastes. And so for that matter, I suppose, do I.
Much of the swelling waste stream of post-war Britain was just being chucked in holes in the ground. Throughout history, this has been the easiest way to dispose of rubbish. What has not been burned has always been buried. Such sites were brought into being by the 1947 Town and Country Planning Act and were called controlled tips. In reality, back in the early post-war period, there was very little control.
It was just backed in the gate and they put a match to it and burnt it. Once it was on fire, it was on fire. You always had local people here scrounging and looking for stuff, yeah. Clothes, all sorts of things. Car batteries, copper cylinders, you know, whatever they could get before it burned. And then we used to come every 10 days or so, we'd come over and push it all in and tidy it up, ready for the next batch to be disposed of.
A controlled tip was a highly flexible form of waste disposal. Almost anything could be buried in one.
They also used to put in all the local sewerage from the septic tanks. It was all disposed of in here as well.
So everything went in?
Everything went in. Anything which was classed as a waste went in. Even car bodies, all sorts of things like that.
Control tips acquired an appalling reputation. No village wanted one anywhere near it.
You feel it may be rather a disgrace to have a rubbish dump on your doorstep.
Simply disgusting and filthy. And that's what it is we're down against. And we are not going to have it at our back doors at all. Eventually, the rats and the flies and the smell and the smoke will spread all over the village.
But in the 60s, with the waste stream expanding rapidly, new tips were being planned and opened all the time. There were hundreds of them scattered across rural Britain.
A rubbish dump in a beauty spot, or a control tip in engine bottom? It would take a far more foolish man than myself to try and give the answer. If the countryside is going to be used generally to accommodate the refuse of towns, in about 30 years' time, we shall be picnicking on all the muck we're not swimming in. Good night.
By the 1960s, rubbish was becoming a health hazard.
The problems arising from refuse and the disposal of waste matter are more serious than ever before. In densely populated areas, this process can trigger off appalling hazards to health. Children, of course, don't understand. They walk innocently into dangers left lurking in their paths by unthinking adults.
Behind this sanitation scare was another change in the composition of household rubbish. Back in the years of austerity, there had been almost no rotting food in household bins. Now, because of rising affluence and new consumption patterns, that was changing. During the 60s, rotting matter became the second largest component of household rubbish.
The bins would get dirty, there's no question about that, and stuff would lodge in the bottom of bins and build up a mat of quite unpleasant material.
The metal dustbin, which dated back to the previous century, was no longer sanitary.
Today, after three quarters of a century of faithful service, the dustbin is going into honourable retirement. Just as collection by horse and cart gave way to motorised collection, so the dustbin is making way for the plastic bag.
Polythene was one of the many plastics that were invented in the mid-20th century. Its first popular use was for hula hoops. Being lightweight and resilient, it was also an ideal bin bag. And as the rubbish of post-war Britain got smellier and dirtier, local authorities began to use polythene bags to collect household waste. Bin bags were also a symptom of the changing culture of waste management. They not only made it easier to throw things away, it was now much harder to recycle the rubbish. As bin bags spread across Britain, out of almost 1,300 local authorities, all but 50 shut down their salvage systems. The recycling infrastructure which had been built up during the war, was now being dismantled. Waste Management now had one overriding priority: move the rubbish as far from the doorstep as fast as possible. These days, when the rubbish starts to pile up at home, it's time for a trip to the local dump. Few who come to the dumps know about their origins. In fact, they date back to the 1960s. This was when the waste management industry first found old furniture clogging up the waste stream. In 1964, the first Habitat store opened in London. It was part of another new trend in post-war consumption. In the late 50s, teenagers had differentiated themselves from their parents by new clothes. Now, 10 years later, they were growing up and settling down. Their approach to homemaking was also a break from the past. But in the mid-60s, the waste management industry was still entirely reliant on doorstep collection. This traditional approach simply couldn't cope with sofas and chairs.
It is sometimes very difficult to get rid of awkward items. I mean, one puts them out with the dustbin and the dustman won't take them away. And some councils charge, and sometimes quite a lot, for taking stuff away.
Well, I think that is part of the cause of the problem, the authority that will not collect or makes a charge for it.
Meanwhile, car ownership was rising. By 1967, over 20% of the population had access to a car.
If you can't get someone to collect your ugly sofa and you've got a vehicle, then there were problems around fly tipping in local areas, countryside, in the vicinity of towns, which were often expensive to clean up and, of course, quite an eyesore, particularly as once fly tipping starts in an area, it tends to attract more fly tipping.
Some of this is obviously from the householder. The slipper shoes. The metal stuff is probably from didikois, a sort of gypsy who are itinerants, usually deal in metal.
So, in 1967, the government passed the Civic Amenity Act. It introduced fines for fly tipping, and all local authorities were ordered to provide a site where the public could safely dispose of unwanted furniture. A dump. Over a century, it had been standard practice to collect rubbish from the doorstep. But now the public brought their rubbish to this yard themselves. The dump was nothing less than a revolution in waste management.
And it was just four little skips, dumped in the yard where the people could come in and just dump the rubbish here, that's right. In the winter, we used to have a big brazier going. We used to take wood out of the skip, burn that, pour a bit of oil over it, set fire to that, because there was no heating. It was like here now. There was no facilities as such. You just stood outside. People had come in and you just, what you got, household? Dump it in there,
Within a few years of the Civic Amenity Act, the fly-tipping scandal of the late 1960s had faded. The dumps also exposed a shocking truth about the values of modern Britain.
You could be standing here one day and you'd get somebody smashed a grandfather clock up. Somebody may have smashed up a grand piano. Yes. And they dump. Grandma died. And they dump the pictures and they dump everything. And everything just came out the cupboards and went straight down the tip.
Antiques were out of fashion in the late 60s. People wanted spaces that were well proportioned and open plan. It was ironic that achieving this uncluttered modernity involved creating ever more waste. The wastefulness of modern life was starkly revealed in Birmingham. The centrepiece of its post-war redevelopment was a new city centre, the Bullring, which opened in 1964.
Oil-fired central heating and air conditioning maintains a pleasant late spring atmosphere all year round.
The Bullring had clean lines and wiped-down surfaces, but in fact it was a machine for generating thousands of tons of rubbish.
A boat show in the centre court marks the opening of the new precinct, which includes over 100 individual shops in its 350,000 square feet. Birmingham proudly claims that no other city can match the Bullring anywhere in the world.
Birmingham's waste management system was creaking under the strain. For 100 years, the city's destructors had burnt rubbish to generate electricity. They'd been the heart of a collection and disposal system that minimised waste. But that meant little to the new head of waste management in the city, a local GP and influential councillor.
Dr. Katie Rogers, she was newly appointed as the chairman of the West Midlands Waste Disposal Committee, and she wanted to see all the waste disposal plants. And as she was walking alongside the furnaces, which were being raked out manually, an aerosol can flew out.
The whole point of the destructor was to reduce rubbish to ash. But an aerosol can didn't burn in the furnace. It became a bomb.
It just flew out of the incinerator. I mean, it came out at quite a rapid rate and nearly hit her. She just sat calmly and said, "I'm not happy with my workers working in those conditions. I want something done about it quickly."
Birmingham promptly closed all destructors. The city turned to a new generation of furnaces called mass burn incinerators. They were vast and completely automated. To improve cleanliness and productivity, rubbish was no longer hand-sorted for recyclables. There wasn't even electricity generation. Everything just went up in smoke. By the end of the 60s, the age of the destructor was over. Meanwhile, the waste stream continued to change and expand, because it wasn't just the waste management industry that was gripped by enthusiasm for whatever was the latest thing. In everyday life, what would once have been considered still new rapidly felt too old. And the people with their foot on the gas were often the producers of goods. They'd learned that they could increase sales by speeding up the rate at which their products appeared outdated. This was called planned obsolescence, a phrase coined by the industrial designer Brooks Stevens.
You became linked with a very controversial phrase, planned obsolescence.
Oh, I wondered when we would get to that.
Well,
but
we're at
remember,
it now.
We remember planned obsolescence.
You came up with the phrase?
I came up with the phrase one night in the Radisson Hotel in Minneapolis. I had to speak the next day before combined advertising agencies and the Rotary Club up there. So I was trying to think of a catchy title. So I said planned obsolescence, then defined it. The desire to own something a little newer, a little better, remember better, a little sooner than is necessary.
Today, planned obsolescence is a derogatory phrase. It's seen as a trick played by producers on their unwitting customers. But back in the 60s, it was presented as progress. This was something that would benefit society.
Consumption has become holy. The big consumer has become the true brother, the faithful, the patriot. And year by year, more of the nation's effort is made to be thrown away.
Post-war prosperity had led to a spending boom, which had created more jobs and higher wages, and so more spending, and so on. Planned obsolescence had then suggested how this consumption-led economic growth could go on forever. No matter how much stuff people bought, they would keep on shopping as long as they regarded what they already owned as old rubbish. It was claimed this would lead to endlessly rising prosperity. But some saw this economic model as piling up mountains of waste.
We can now make more of practically everything than we can ever possibly hope to use. And to prosper, we must become a race of massive consumers, wasting to live.
But planned obsolescence contributed to yet another unprecedented problem for the waste management industry. Now, dustmen were being asked to collect and dispose of old TVs and fridges. From the back end, modernity just looked messier and messier. The Revopac dust cart was introduced in 1971.
Revopac is a dustman's best friend. Its enormously powerful teeth will crush and digest anything on the menu.
The hydraulic-powered steel rake compacted bulky rubbish to one-fifth of its size. So the Revopac carried five times as much waste as conventional dust carts. The design of the Revopac reveals how recycling, once integral to waste management, was now almost irrelevant. By the 70s, the recycling rate had fallen to less than 3%. In one promotional film, the Revopac was shown compacting a fridge. During the 70s, the volume of waste grew by as much as 5% a year. Nearly every local authority switched to Revopacs. Almost all the nation's waste stream flowed through these steel jaws. By the mid-70s, every week in Britain, almost 500,000 tons of rubbish was carted off in a compacted slurry and poured out onto the local tip. The waste management industry had once helped Britons contain the waste stream. Now it was opening the floodgates. Then, in the late 70s, the wastefulness of modernity became suddenly apparent to all, because the dustmen went on strike. In the first few weeks of 1979, Britain's streets became overrun with rotting rubbish. This dispute was initially seen as a further symptom of a wider economic crisis. But in a consumer society, a refuse collection strike exposes the shocking truth about the way people are living. The dustman's strike lasted 5 weeks. And after it, the waste management industry would never be the same again. Critics of the Consumer Society had accused it of building a mountain of waste. But by the late 70s, the throwaway mindset had been ruling Britain for a generation. And wastefulness is a habit that's easy to learn, but hard to forget. Two big ideas that shape how we think now emerged from the rubbish of these decades. The first was privatization of public services. This began with refuse collection. The other big idea from these years was environmental awareness. This was inspired by a growing fear of our wastefulness.
There is, in fact, a general forecast of a breakdown of world society in the first decades of the next century.
Making profits and being green aren't necessarily opposites. But in the 70s and 80s, they seemed like two sides of a conflict about fundamental values. How to deal with our rubbish became a critical issue that would decide the future of Britain. By the 1970s, Britain had become a consumer society. Shopping for new things had become a national enthusiasm. It gave people the sense that their lives were improving and kept the economy going. But as people bought more, they threw more away. How to manage the waste became a critical issue that would dominate political and even cultural life for the next decade. One immediate impact of the winter of discontent was that a man with a radical idea for the waste management industry found himself on the fringe of power. There was a new Conservative government led by Margaret Thatcher. This was a great opportunity for businessman and Tory councillor David Evans.
If anyone has a reason to crack open the Krug at 10 in the morning, it's David Evans. For the first time, shares in his company, Brengreen, have topped £1.
Brengreen was actually an office cleaning company, but Evans believed it could do much more. He set out to convince the new government that Brengreen could take over some of the public cleansing work then being done by the state. For over a century, domestic waste had been managed by local authorities. In some towns, that was why the council had come into being. But there was no law against outsourcing some of this work to a private contractor. Southend Council was then having trouble with its refuse collection service. Every time a new house was built in the town, the dustman demanded a bonus payment for collecting the rubbish from it. Some routes with lots of new houses had become extremely costly for the council. There was also blatant corruption. Out of these local difficulties came the birth of the privatisation of Britain's public services. Because in 1981, Southend Council handed over its refuse collection service to David Evans to sort out. Privatisation meant the council's pay deals were scrapped overnight because all the dustmen were made redundant. Most were rehired, but on terms that suited the private contractor. a Bren Green subsidiary called Exclusive Cleaning. So much money was saved by ending the bonus schemes and corruption that he could raise the basic wage of those who were kept on.
It took about 3 months to settle down. And after that, you know, things became normal.
Margaret Thatcher had come to power promising to clean up the mess that Britain was in. David Evans believed he'd shown her how this could be done, because despite its profits, Exclusive Cleaning was charging Southend's ratepayers £500,000 a year less than when the council had collected the rubbish.
Everyone seems to agree that what happened here in Southend was a revolution. And right now it seems to be one that's spreading. Up and down the country, there are no fewer than 117 other local authorities who've paid £100 each for copies of Southend's privatisation blueprint.
Privatisation had begun. But there was a rival reaction to the winter of discontent. It was also a watershed in the environmental movement. In the 70s, some in Britain came to believe that the consumer society was creating an environmental catastrophe. They now hoped that the streets filled with rotting rubbish would make people more aware of society's wastefulness. A government research program called the War on Waste declared that we all instinctively feel there is something wrong in a society which wastes and discards resources on such a scale as we do today. The critical need for a war on waste had been proved by science. In 1972, in an experiment called The Limits to Growth, an international panel of statisticians looked into the future of the planet. Instead of a crystal ball, they used a computer. They programmed in predictions of population expansion and economic activity. The results were shocking.
From a very large number of computer runs, making various assumptions, adopting various maxima and minima, there is in fact a general forecast of a breakdown of world society in the first decades of the next century.
The limits to growth suggested the world faced a stark choice: cut down waste or face imminent global collapse. Margaret Thatcher prided herself on her ability to make tough choices. And in 1983, following victory in the Falklands War, she had just been re-elected with the largest majority for a generation. Thatcher now had the power to give Britain any medicine she thought it needed. In the 80s, Thatcher was fighting a running battle with Britain's local authorities. She accused them of being bloated spendthrifts. And in 1988, a new Local Government Act was passed. It enforced what was called competitive tendering for various local authority activities, including refuse collection. From now on, household bins would be emptied by whoever gave the best value for money. Widespread privatisation followed immediately. The privatisation of waste management was the beginning of a period of structural change. the Thatcher government sold off £29 billion worth of public utilities and nationalised industries. This led to a new emphasis in British public services. Instead of being managed by the state's bureaucrats, the country was now being served by its entrepreneurs. This was more than a new economics. It was a new culture, a shift away from a society that depended on collective responsibility to one built on individualism. Not everyone bought into the values of 80s Britain. The Green movement was deeply suspicious of the profit motive. This doubt dated right back to the establishment of the environmental pressure group Friends of the Earth. In 1971, activists blocked the doorstep of Schweppes' headquarters with empty bottles. Friends of the Earth were trying to highlight how disposable packaging was a key contributor to Britain's mountain of rubbish.
It was no joke when there was the strike in London and there were lots and lots of bits and pieces lying around and rats and flies and Lord knows what. Now, it's irresponsible of the packaging industry to compound this problem when really they should be helping all the rest of us look at the refuse disposal problem and solve it.
Schweppes didn't change its policy. A spokesperson for the packaging industry admitted why.
It's more convenient for the housewife to have disposable packages.
It's also more profitable for your companies, of course.
This had not escaped me.
Many environmentalists came to believe that private businesses would never reduce waste, because that meant less profits. But then someone found a way to make money out of recycling. In 1977, in this car park in Barnsley, Ron England opened the first bottle bank. He was an engineer at a local glass-making company and knew that the technology existed for recycling bottle glass. But to make this process viable, he needed a steady supply of empties.
We came up with bottle bank. We didn't want some of the window-pane glass going into the banks. So by saying bottle bank, it shows that it's a bottle. The actual symbol on the first bottle type of bottle banks was actually a bottle with two bees around it. So we were trying to say to the general public, bottles please.
With stories about an environmental apocalypse hitting the headlines, a trip to the bottle bank made people feel good about themselves. Buckingham Palace got one. And when a bottle bank appeared on another national treasure, Ron knew he'd pulled it off.
If you look closely on Coronation Street, on the wall by the doctor's surgery, there is some bottle banks there. So bottle banks became part of the everyday life.
Bottle banks were joined by banks for paper, aluminium and old clothes. By the mid-80s, supermarket car parks were becoming mini recycling centres.
There was started to do quite a bit of public attitude survey work when these recycling systems came in, and clearly everyone, attitude-wise, more or less 80-90% all would think it's a good thing. When you actually talk about their behaviour, when did you last go to a bottle bank? What did then, you know, they're scratching their heads and they wouldn't be able to remember. And so attitude great, behaviour appalling. That's the bottom line.
It turned out that only a fraction of the recyclables in the waste stream were getting picked up by the Bring system. It was clear that an effective recycling system would have to deal with the rubbish in the household bin. Only a generation earlier, during the Second World War, the waste management industry had recovered millions of tons of critical resources from people's bins. This had been possible because citizens sorted their rubbish on their own doorstep. But those were the days of "we're all in it together." Britain was now in the age of the individual. The history of waste management contains many technological fixes that worked, but didn't last. In the early 20th century, incinerators had reduced rubbish to ash, using the heat this created to generate electricity. However, the noxious fumes this produced were expensive to clean, and incineration fell out of fashion. By the late 70s, 90% of British rubbish went to landfill. This led to experiments that sought to reduce the volume of the waste going into the ground. The flats on this council estate in Sheffield all had a powerful liquidiser below the sink. Even tin cans could just be flushed away. The system didn't catch on. Britons weren't changing their wasteful behaviour, but they were assured the environment was safe because the waste management industry was now obliged to clean up the mess. In 1986, in Loscow in Derbyshire, two homes were destroyed when gas seeping out of an old landfill exploded. What happened at Loscow could happen at any landfill. The problem was that Britons were throwing out too much food. Almost 30% of late 20th century rubbish was organic matter. As it rotted away underground, it produced methane, which is highly flammable. Methane can continue to be produced for 20 years after the last load of rubbish is buried. A landfill could become a huge ticking bomb. But this explosive liability turned into an asset. This is an electricity generator, which runs off methane gas that has been piped out of Panfil. Rotting rubbish buried here decades ago is still producing enough power to light up 10,000 homes. This harnessing of the energy from waste made even burying it seem environmentally friendly.
Essentially, we were dealing with an economic circumstance which, you know, landfill became king.
The war on waste was lost. Throughout the 80s, the waste stream continued to expand. Disposable nappies had been invented a generation before, but only really took off in Britain during the late 20th century. They were just one flow within a waste flood of disposable goods. Pens, razors, shopping bags were now being used once, then thrown away. Despite rising concern for the environment, people were choosing convenience. The waste management industry was struggling to keep up. Simple solution to more waste: bigger bins. Though well established in Europe, the wheelie bin was completely new to Britain. It led to an immediate doubling in the efficiency of refuse collection. In the 80s, the wheelie bin spread across Britain like the latest craze. But many local authorities reported that the wheelie bin led to an immediate increase in the waste stream. At 240 litres, the wheelie bins could handle three times as much rubbish as the traditional dustbins they replaced. And local authorities soon discovered that people were filling them up. This was because of what's known as Parkinson's law of rubbish. The more bin space households have, the more they throw away. It's a fundamental flaw that undermines improvements in waste management to this day. During the 1980s, excess became acceptable. But environmentalism was changing. All over Britain, landfills are closing, sometimes before they're full. This is because evidence of man-made climate change has made resources precious again. So the waste management industry is finding ways to preserve them, often returning to techniques lost since the mid-20th century. Separating our rubbish into different bins makes us feel better. But improving waste management isn't enough. At the heart of 1940s Britain was a mindset exemplified by make do and mend. People only threw away what they could no longer find a use for. That way of thinking is not being rediscovered. We still create rubbish like there's no tomorrow and expect the waste management industry to clear up our mess.
Oh, my old man's a dustman. He wears a dustman's hat. He wears gold blimey trousers and he lives in the council flat. He looks a proper nana in his great big gobnail boots. He's got such a job to pull them up, but he calls them daisy roots. Oh, my old man's a dustman, he wears a dustman's hat. He wears gold blimey trousers, and he lives in the council flat. Next time you see a dustman looking all pale and sad, don't kick him in the dustbin. He